Let's shift our studies now to the idea of the normal distribution. We've talked about the discrete probability distributions. We talked about the binomial, which is a discrete probability distribution. And now we're going to concentrate on another named distribution, that being, of course, the normal distribution. So, like usual, let's take a look quickly at the learning objectives, which you want to get out of these next several videos. First of all, we want to be able to convert values from a non-standard normal variable to values of a standard normal variable. And we'll talk about the difference between a standard and a non-standard, a normal distribution. We want to compute probabilities associated with both the standard normal and a non-standard normal. And we want to be able to compute percentiles for normal random variables. So let's start off talking about some properties of the normal distribution. The normal distribution is actually at first continuous distribution. And this is a comparison to the binomial, which is discrete. Now remember the definition of a discrete variable or discrete random variable compared to a continuous. The discrete, it's countable. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that sort of a thing. And that's what we have with the binomial. 1 success out of 10 trials, 2 successes out of 10 trials, 2 through 7 successes out of 10 trials, that sort of a thing. The normal distribution is the bell-shaped curve. Remember earlier when we talked about the empirical rule and we said it's mound-shaped? Well, this mound is actually the normal distribution. It's called the bell-shaped curve. The distribution is centered at the mean, so right down the middle is mu. And since the distribution is bell-shaped, hence it's symmetric, both the mean and the median have the same value. So the mean and the median are both right smack down the middle. That's an equal sign right there. It didn't come out really good. Now, the total area under the curve, this is kind of important, the total area under the curve is 1. So when I draw, oops, that was not very pretty. That's a little better. So when I draw this bell-shaped curve, all of the area here, if I add up all this area that's underneath the curve, and actually you have to use calculus techniques to do that. Fortunately, the technology will do it for us. All this area equals 1. Now that's kind of important because probability is associated, the probability is actually associated with the area under the curve. And the probability a value is observed between any two points in the distribution is equal to the area under the curve. So let's just say I had here, say a mean, some type of sub-distribution here, where the mean was equal to, say 100. And I wanted to know what the probability is of being between, say, 110 and 120. Well, that would be the area under the curve between 110 and 120. That would be your probability. That's why it's so important that the entire area is 1. Because the area or the probability, if you add up all the probability across the sample space, you know it's always equal to 1. Hence, all the area under the curve would be equal to 1. If the area under the curve was greater than 1 or less than 1, this idea of probability wouldn't make any sense. Now, the actual curve extends to plus and minus infinity. In other words, when I draw this curve out, we stop it like this, but in reality this tail goes on and on and on out to positive infinity, and this tail goes on and on and on out to negative infinity. And it never ever touches the horizontal axis. There's always a little gap there. If I were to zoom in on this right there, that little piece right here would look like this. If I were to zoom in on that piece right there, it would look like this. If I were to zoom in this piece right here, it would look like that. And so forth. This goes on and on and on and on, never ending. You may recall in algebra the idea of asymptotic behavior. We say that this curve asymptotically goes to zero, with zero being the x-axis or horizontal axis. Asymptotically means it gets infinitely close, but is never actually equal to zero. Well, that should right away bring up a red flag. How can I add up all the area under the curve and it be one if these tails go out to infinity? So I'm always adding area to it. See, that should be a little bit mind-boggling. And actually, we need a little bit of calculus to truly comprehend what's going on. But I can do another quick demo here to give you an idea. And this actual example we'll give you is really good for parties. You could like win free stuff at parties with this. Let's just suppose I have a triangle. And let's just say that the base here is 1. And the height is also 1. So we know that the area of this triangle is equal to 1/2 height times base, which in this case is 1/2 1 times 1, which is 1/2. So I know that the area of this triangle is 1/2. Okay, so suppose I did this. Suppose I split this up. Now I have 1, 2, 3, 4 triangles. If I add up the area of all 4 triangles, I will once again have 1/2. Well, what happens if I do that again and again and again? Now I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. There's 16 triangles there. If I add up the area of all 16, I will still get 1/2. Well, if I repeat this process infinitely number of times, I'm going to end up with an infinite number of triangles in there. So if I add up the area, so let's say the total area, area T total, will be equal to the sum I equals 1 to infinity. And this is actually not quite proper mathematical notation. I don't want to talk about limits and so forth in this class, but you get the idea. Of the, I'm going to say ai, which is small ai, that's the area of the small triangle. And there's infinite number of those, so I keep making them smaller, smaller, smaller. That area is going to be 1/2. The whole point here is I added up the area from an infinite number of items and ended up with a finite number. I don't know about you, but I think that's pretty cool.